Hello and welcome to the Whistling Podcast. My name is David Prinsorki. Today I'll be starting a short series on the history of whistling. This podcast will eventually be all about personalities and the music they created, but I want to begin with what there is to be found out about the origin of whistling in humans. Unfortunately, there's not really much to be found on the subject. There appear to be only two scholarly articles about it and one short book. Studying the history of whistling becomes much easier when we get to recorded music, roughly around 1860. On April 9th, 1860, the French inventor Edouard Léon Scott de Martinville created the first sound recording in history. He recorded the folk song Au clair de la lune on the phonautograph, the earliest device known to preserve sound. After that, in 1877, Thomas Edison invented the phonograph. This was the first machine that could record sound and play it back. But what about whistling before that? Well, it's a pretty difficult thing to suss out. We can only turn to literature, and as we will find, this is tricky business. As I said before, I can only find two scholarly papers written on the subject of the history of whistling, and will begin with the one written by Peter F. Ostwald in 1959. I will read as much of the article that seems appropriate and give my commentary on it. I am new to the research into the history of whistling, so I am learning new and fascinating things all the time. I would appreciate anyone in the know to point out my errors and would love to know more. So who was Peter F. Ostwald? Well, where else can you find a good summary of a person's life than in his obituary? I am now reading his obituary from the New York Times, written by Anthony Tomasini. So, Dr. Peter F. Ostwald. He was an author, professor of psychiatry, and the founding director of the Health Program for Performing Artists at the University of California at San Francisco. Quote, Dr. Ostwald was recognized internationally for his work on the interaction between music and psychiatry. He was the author of a pioneering biography on Robert Schumann, entitled Schumann, The Inner Voices of a Musical Genius, 1985. This was the first work to attempt an exact diagnosis of Schumann's severe mental disorders as they related to his compositions and creative life. Dr. Ostwald was born in Berlin on January 5, 1928. He received his medical degree from the University of California at San Francisco in 1950. After service in the Army Medical Corps in Germany, he returned to the university in 1956 to join the staff of the Langley Porter Psychiatric Institute. There, in 1986, he founded the Health Program for Performing Artists, a voluntary group of specialists engaged in research, education, and clinical care of the particular mental and medical problems afflicting musicians, dancers, and other performing artists, both professionals and students. For many years, he served as mental health consultant to the San Francisco Conservatory of Music, unquote. He wrote two other books, one about Vaclav Nijinsky and another about Glenn Gould. He was an amateur violinist and married to a concert pianist. He died on May 25, 1996 of cancer. So I say rest in peace, Peter F. Ostwald, and I thank you for writing a paper on whistling. Could Dr. Ostwald whistle? I don't know. I wonder about people interested in the phenomenon of whistling. Their writings never seem to say whether they can or can't. So, on to the article. When People Whistle, 1959, Peter F. Ostwald, University of California School of Medicine. Abstract. The shrill, high-pitched musical sound produced when air is forced through a small opening or against a thin edge is called whistling. This paper treats whistling as a special form of human communication. A simpler form of communication than speech, it requires less training in the production and perception of sounds. Yet whistling is more difficult than noise-making, whose sounds are byproducts of unskilled movements like eating or breathing and are universally understood. In terms of its history and in connection with the experiences of the whistler and the listener, Whistling provides interesting information about the psychology of sound. A study of whistling therefore belongs in the analysis of human behavior. So before we get to the first section, I do want to point out that Peter F. Ostwald's specialty is psychiatry and not history. But in the first section here on the history of whistling, he does point to many areas of study which will be topics of later podcasts. So here we go, part one, the history of whistling. Though the exact function of whistling in the animal world is not known, there are many examples which may shed light on human whistling. The wild, whistling swan of North America, for example, emits a soft, distinctive musical tone. The large mountain marmots of the Northwest also whistle and are nicknamed whistlers. There is a whistle pig, that is a woodchuck, whistle fish, and the whistle moth.
Sound unavailable.
Possibly whistling sounds serve these animals to recognize each other, to stay in groups, to frighten predators, and to time their reactions for feeding, mating, and other self-preservative acts. Reference Conrad Lorenz, 1952. Humans whistle by directing a stream of air through the mouth or nose. While there is almost no written information about whistling, one can assume that ancient tribes whistled. So here Dr. Ostwald references Egon Welez. He was the editor of Ancient and Oriental Music by Oxford University Press. I'll have to say I was a little bit apprehensive about reading one of those old Oxford University Press books, but reading the section on ancient music was actually quite interesting and wonderful. I was amazed at how integral music was to ancient peoples. I couldn't find any reference in the section on ancient music to whistling except for instrumental whistles or mechanical whistles, but it was interesting nonetheless. This assumption that ancient people whistled has to remain what it is, an assumption. I think it's easy to imagine some ancient person imitating birds in some totemistic way and thus learned how to whistle.
Instruments used to whistle, as well as visual depiction of musicians using pipes and whistles, have been recovered from archaeological diggings. Savages generally used whistles made of cane that were often blown with the nose. In Mesopotamia, mouth whistles capable of making 1 to 3 distinct tones were used. The Chinese employed clay whistles in the form of frogs, birds, and other animals.
So I just happen to live in China at present, and I've actually bought a few of these little clay whistles. I have a dog, a rooster, and a toucan. The kind that I have, you fill with water, and they actually sound quite amazing.
Tubes of bamboo with reeds inserted into the walls were used for whistling during funeral processions, and Peking puppet plays still use the kuu chinzi, a free reed whistle, to imitate chickens and infants.
I really have no idea what he's talking about when he mentions a kuu chinzi. I can just imagine that it's some bad old Wade Giles transliteration. But what I think he's talking about is the modern instrument called the suona. It sounds like this. And it does play the roles that he mentions in the article, for funerals, for Beijing opera, etc.
The whistle pots of the South American Indians consisted of 2 communicating earthenware vessels, half filled with water. Occasionally, whistling was used as a form of language, and such languages may have characterized many early hunting cultures. The only whistle language in existence today goes back to the 15th century. The 30,000 inhabitants of La Gomera, one of the Canary Islands, communicate by whistling often to the exclusion of speech. Their language, called silbo, is audible for several miles and is ideally suited to the mountainous terrain for greeting calls, message exchange, and joke telling. Only the pitch of the whistle is varied to indicate different words. With the growth of instrumental music in Europe, whistles came to be used in the form of Pandean pipes, and later on as the piccolo or little flute. Whistles also figured in the mechanical orchestras of the 18th century. They were blown by steam or air like high-pitched organ pipes. Instructions for the use of the bird whistle were also published at that time. It would appear that whistling gradually came to be associated with the activities of socially underprivileged or poorly educated persons. In any event, throughout Europe and even in the United States, upper-class persons may tend to frown on whistling and may outlaw it in formal restaurants, art museums, and other public places. Today, whistles are also used by children as toys and by steam kettles and policemen as warning devices. Several contemporary examples of whistling deserve mention. In the movie The Bridge on the River Kwai, British prisoners whistled Colonel Bogey while marching as a means of keeping up their morale in the face of oppression during captivity. Engineers concerned with the mechanical production of artificial speech by machines like the voter make use of hissing and whistling sounds.
The machine uses only two sounds produced electrically. One of these represents the breath. The other, the vibration of the vocal cords. There are no phonograph records or anything of that sort. Only electrical circuits, such as are used in telephone practice.
Let's see how you put expression into a sentence. Say, she saw me with no expression.
She saw me.
Now say it in answer to these questions. Who saw you?
She saw me.
Whom did she see?
She saw me.
Did she see you or hear you?
She saw me.
Numerous colloquial expressions hint at the usage of whistles in social discourse. One might whistle for, or demand a handout, go whistle, that is, tell secretly a story, whistle down the wind, argue to no purpose, or whistle off, dismiss an employee. And that's all Peter F. Ostwald has to say about the history of whistling. As I said before, his specialty is psychiatry, so the paper goes on to discuss more psychological issues, such as how humans whistle, what the whistler experiences, what the listener experiences, and also the function of whistling in human relations. I have some more comments on this first section, and we'll go through each paragraph one by one. First of all, he talks about whistling in the animal kingdom and mentions a few examples. I do plan on doing a whole episode on animals that whistle, and as we'll find out, there are more examples of animals that whistle. Of course, we'll be talking about birds eventually. In my opinion, birds are probably the primary inspiration for human whistling. The first sentence of the second paragraph is, "Humans whistle by directing a stream of air through the mouth or nose." Of course, in my bag of tricks, I do have a nose whistle. But before reading this article, I wasn't aware that people actually can whistle melodies through their nose. I looked up some YouTube videos, and sure enough, there are quite talented nose whistlers. We may take that up in a future podcast. It seems like a rare skill, but it exists nonetheless. I was a little disappointed that Dr. Ostwald used the word savages. 1959 seems a little late in the game to use the term savages. It sounds like something from the 19th century. There are a lot more examples of musical whistles or mechanical whistles, and that is another podcast episode. He also talks about whistled languages and only mentions one example, Silbo, but this is another podcast subject, whistled languages, and there seem to be a lot of examples of this around the world. Before reading this article, I was unaware of the voter, or the speech synthesizing machine. This machine was invented around 1939. Of course, as a child in the 70s, I knew about the Speak and Spell, and speech synthesis has come a long way since then. I also plan on doing a podcast on the subject of how the word whistle is used in different expressions in the English language. So now to complete this podcast, I'll read the conclusion to the paper. I'll leave a link in the podcast's notes to where you can find this article and read it in its entirety if that's your desire. So here we go, the conclusion. Conclusion. From this information about whistling and human and animal behavior, whistling appears to be a special form of communication which lacks the complexity of speech and music, yet is more complex than simple noisemaking. The experiences of the whistler concern mouth and body movements that may be pleasurable, as well as thoughts and emotions that range from excitement to depression. An analysis of the effects of whistling upon listeners shows that whistles arouse, annoy, alarm, and control others. Finally, whistling has its function in human relations. Whistling seems to help calm a person who is in danger and distress. It reinforces the whistler's belief that he is alive and aids in self-orientation. By whistling, an individual can establish contact with others. People whistle to communicate feelings which cannot be readily expressed in words. The end. So I think that's enough to digest for 1 week. On the next podcast, I'll be diving into a work called Whistling in Antiquity by A.V. van Stekelenburg of the University of Stellenbosch. Until then, avoid the plague, and I'll see you next time.